guys. Excuse me. Welcome back. Today we are going to be starting on the first full rulebook in a while. Dwarfs. This is the 8th edition Dwarf rulebook. And as such is going to be lacking much of the charm that the older rule books had. However, it's going to have a lot more in-depth lore. So, you know, it's a little bit of a give and take. But anyways, let's just, let's jump in. The Dwarfs. The Dwarfs are an ancient race, and the lands they claim as their own lie on the edge of the so-called civilized lands of men. There, rising high above the world in an endless series of jagged peaks, stand the world's edge mountains. Beneath those snow-covered pinnacles, the dwarves have dug into the bedrock of the world, carving out mines and halls into their kingdom, which they call the Karaz Angkor, meaning either the everlasting realm or the mountain realm, as the dwarf word for mountain and extreme durability are the same. There, towering peaks are crowned with lookout towers, impenetrable gates are wrought into the mountainsides, and hidden entrances are hewn where they are least expected, secreted in tumbling chasms behind waterfalls, or fashioned to bend seamlessly into rugged cliff faces. From these formidable strongholds, the dwarf armies, known as throngs, march forth to do battle. The world's edge mountains are harsh and unforgiving, are a harsh and unforgiving environment, where avalanches and freezing winds that can strip the hide off a grizzly bear are not considered the main threats. It is a rocky realm where monsters hunt among the peaks, and the passes are the main paths for invading armies. Living tides of orcs and goblins sweep the lands, while from the east stomp ogre armies seeking to prey upon the weak. To the north are barbarian tribes of men who draw upon the dark gods for unnatural powers. Only by dint of their stubborn vigilance and sturdy axe work have the dwarves endured. In a bygone era, the dwarves once dominated the old world. While the race of man was not more than fur-clad savages using stone tools, the bright shield walls of the dwarves marched across the continent, an implacable steel-clad advance. They were driven by an endless quest for precious minerals, for dwarves lust after gold and gems, and their mining expeditions spread to distant lands. In those days, even the poorest of holds could boast of riches beyond the wealthiest kings of other races. That golden age is now long gone. However, woe betide anyone who dares speak of this decline within earshot of a dwarf, for they remain a proud people, and even the slightest remark or insult, real or perceived, can goad them into fury. Dwarves do not forget grudges. Indeed, they harbor them. And there is no word for forgiveness in their language. Once someone has made an enemy of a dwarf, they have made a foe that will last their lifetime, and the lives of their descendants as well. Dwarves record any slight or transgression against them, and each stronghold has its own book of grudges. Within Karazakarak, the capital of the dwarf realm and seat of the High King, resides the Damas Kron, the great book of grudges. That its creation dates back to the dwarf's first ancestor speaks of how deeply grudge-bearing is ingrained into the dwarf psyche. Given that their history is rife with bloody battles, tragedies, and invasions suffered, there is a lengthy backlog of wrongdoing against their kind, a legacy of unrequited vengeance inherited from their fathers and, in turn, from their ancestors of old. Stubbornness given form. Dwarves are shorter and stouter than men, and are known for their broad shoulders, beards, and stamina. The most defining characteristic of dwarves, however, is a gruff and stubborn nature. The dwarves' innate obstinacy is the stuff of legends, and countless tales speak of both the great fortunes and the tragedies of this epic resolve. Positive accounts of the dwarf's tenacity speak of perseverance against all odds, a refusal to ever willingly accept defeat. Other sagas tell of dogged loyalty, of dwarves holding true to their word, honoring oaths despite vast dangers or the passage of centuries. It is this same fierce determination that drives dwarf craftsmen to attain the pinnacle of engineering and architectural wonder that they realize through sweat and sheer perseverance. Yet, the adamancy of the dwarves has oft proved to be the very cause of their downfall. Indeed, their unforgiving nature has led the dwarves to fight horrific and bloody wars. By taking slight at the least provocation or by refusing to back down, the dwarf race has lost countless allies and begun untold battles in which they had little chance of surviving. Even in their unmatched feats of work, the belligerent streak of dwarves causes problems. Their fabled intolerance of flaws mean that upon perceiving the slightest defect, they will set about any amount of painstaking labor to rectify matters to their complete satisfaction. If this means wrecking all progress and starting over, then so be it. A fire undimmed. Although many of their ancient strongholds now lie in ruin and have become the lairs of evil creatures, the glories of their past are not forgotten by the dwarf race. Kept alive through unflagging memory, the sagas of forgotten days can still be heard, sung now in the half-empty halls of the surviving mountain fortresses. Yet these are not the dirges of a defeated race, and their tunes tug upon the dwarves, stirring within them a fierce warrior's pride. Within the stony heart of every dwarf there resides a deep-set and burning desire to strike out the grudges of old, to rise again to a just rulership of the land, and, most of all, to reclaim what once was their own. The current dwarf High King has called the dwarves to battle, urging all the holds and clans of the Karazangor to march out of their mountain fortresses and begin a war of reclamation. He is Thorgrim Grudgebearer, so named because he has sworn a mighty oath to avenge every wrong done to his people. Bold words, soon backed by bold deeds. That which is wrong with the world that we cannot fix with the blades of our axes, we shall surely avenge. Thorgrim Grudgebearer. By axe and hammer it will be done. Heeding their high king, the dwarfs flexed their mailed fists, marching forth to battle, for even thus diminished, they are still a mighty power in the world. Ages of warfare have forged the dwarves into a hardy and grim race of warriors. What they lack in numbers is more than compensated for by martial prowess and sheer determination, to say nothing of the matchless quality of their arms and armor. Dwarves fight as heavy infantry, eschewing cavalry, for it is not their way to ride upon beasts. In truth, the rugged mountains they call home are not conducive to cavalry, and regardless, a dwarf is too short of stature to ride upon a horse, although they are far too proud to admit it. Instead, dwarves fight on foot, as is proper, and as they have always done. Each warrior is clad in finely crafted mail and is armed with a superbly forged axe, hammer, or mattock, which they can wield to deadly effect. Dwarves are technologically inventive, having developed advanced engineering, pioneered the use of black powder, and deciphered the secrets of steam power. This knowledge manifests itself upon the battlefields in the form of engines of war. There are older designs, such as the time-honored catapults and bolt throwers, along with the first cannons used in the Old World. To this devastating arsenal, dwarves have added newer and still stranger devices. Now being built in the workshops under the mountains are flame-spewing cannons, multi-barreled field guns, and flying machines that bring death from above. Only their own conservatives barbarism slows the pace of new development. Yet even so, dwarves can field more machineries of destruction than any other army. Whole batteries capable of bombarding a foe into bloody pulp. Should a foe survive being blasted by cannonballs and sheets of fire, they must weather the bolts and bullets shot by dwarf crossbows and handguns. Thus thin and bloodied, the enemy must then confront the dwarf shield wall. There, faced with axe, hammer, and red-hot vengeance, few stand for long. And many foes down the ages have learned that pleading to dwarves for mercy is a lost cause. They are easy to offend, and the only reparations they accept are paid in blood. Perhaps most baffling to other races are the dwarves known as slayers. These individuals have undertaken a vow to die in battle. For the dwarves, pride is a matter of life and death. Those who have taken the slayer's oath shave their heads, save for a distinctive crest dyed bright orange. Of all their race, only the slayers go to war unarmored, but they are such fierce fighters that many fail in their pledge. That is, they do not fall in battle, but emerge victorious. Thus, the slayer must hunt a greater doom, seeking ever more powerful foes. Like the most majestic of mountain peaks, the everlasting realm has weathered each storm, enduring ages of battering and besiegement by foes unending. Yet, both mountains and the race of dwarves still stand, proud and defiant. The long saga of war and treachery that is the dwarves' history has left a bitter legacy. But, as High King Thorgrim Grudgebearer has avowed, the time for endurance is over. A new era is dawning, and the time for vengeance has begun. So far we have the most technologically advanced race, fueled by rage. History of the dwarves. The dwarves believe their history begins with the awakening of their firstborn, chief amongst whom were their pantheon of gods. Of these, the most important by far are Grungni, Grimnir, and Valaya. According to dwarf tradition, these gods were carved by time from the rocks of the mountains, birthed by stone itself. They believe that the whole of their race is descended directly from these ancient ancestors. The first dwarves inhabited the southern portion of the world's edge mountains. As their numbers grew, they began to migrate northwards, splitting into different clans, many of which were led by a living god. Many legends are attached to this period, and the dwarves attribute mighty deeds to their ancestors, such as the war against dragons, an event that created the infamous Blackfire Pass, and the tale of the Forge Father, Grungi's epic quest to master metal, passing the knowledge of mining, smelting, and the forging of iron and steel to his scions. As all of this happened in the dawn of dwarf history, it is more akin to mythic tale than a hard fact, and it is impossible to pinpoint exactly when the dwarves reached the lands they now inhabit. Excuse me, I don't know if you can tell, I still have a bit of a stuffy nose. In their earliest stages, the Dawi, as the dwarves call themselves in their own language, were cave dwellers who fashioned primitive tools from flint and eked out a living in the bleak and inhospitable mountains. Then, as now, the dwarves were hardy folk, and they endured despite the hardships. Led by their gods themselves, the dwarf civilization soon developed from a stone era into a bold new age. With the iron and then steel weapons and armor that Grungi taught them to make, the dwarves were able to fight off the terrors of the mountains and expand into new territory. It was Grimnir, the warrior god of the dwarves, who staved off giants, trolls, and marauding orcs while teaching his charges the arts of battle. It was Valaya, a dwarf goddess, who showed the wandering dwarves the value of strong dwellings and of the importance still developing clans. Oh, I'm so sorry. That was kind of loud. As the dwarves spread throughout the mountains, seeking out new veins of precious metals, they found the system of strongholds behind them. Each settlement was a small fortified realm centered around a productive mine, a bastion in the rocky wilderness. The largest of these became known as Carrix, the dwarf word for mountain stronghold, and the glory of these great fortress cities was fabled. Eventually, the dwarves reached the northernmost peaks of the World's Edge Mountains, a desolate region scattered with the bleached bones of many creatures. They called this cold and barren land Zorn Uzkull, or the Great Skull Land. Here, most dwarves turned back, for the harsh region provided a scarcity of mineral wealth, although a few of the boldest clans pushed onwards, some turning west into the lands now called Norska, others heading east across the Great Skull Land and daring to enter the Mountains of Morn. Thus was founded the Great Dwarf Realm, the Karaz-Angor. At its center lay the great city of Karazakarak, the Everpeak. For a long while, the widely dispersed clans maintained contact with each other, while each delved more deeply beneath the mountains. Soon, however, they would be separated by a growing storm unlike anything seen before. The Coming of Chaos. According to the account in the Great Book of Grudges, the most ancient dwarf book of lore, the coming of chaos rent the earth and sky and tore the very mountains apart. Turbulent winds of multicolored magic clouded the air. The dwarves maintained that Grunki warned his people that such a time might come, and he told them to take refuge deep beneath the mountains. There, they sheltered at the winds of magic, as the winds of magic erupted out of the north and scoured the world. When the tempest passed, it left in its wake a layer of dust that hastened corruption. When the dwarves emerged from their underground dwellings, they found the world was a very changed place. Mutated beasts and rage-filled monstrosities prowled the mountains, but there was something even worse. During the great storm, demons had burst forth from the realm of chaos, and now they stalked the lands, seeking to slay all they found. It was not long before the mountain strongholds of the dwarves were ferociously assailed. The demons quickly found out the dwarves were far from defenseless. Ancient tales tell how Grunki taught his people to inscribe magical runes on their weapons and armor, allowing them to stand against the creatures of chaos that assaulted them. Valaya used her protections to ward off the dark magic of their enemies, dampening their dread powers. It was Grimnir, equipped with two mighty axes and armor harder than the mountains themselves, who launched the counterattack. With their blazing warrior god at the fore, the dwarves clove a path up and down the mountain range, killing so many of their foe that, for a time, the World's Edge mountains were clear of demons. Grimnir himself pressed the attack, pursuing his enemy with a relentless fury that dimmed only when the last foe was slain. The elves. It was at this point that the dwarves first made contact with the elves, a fleet of elven warships, captained by Kalidor Dragon Damer, had been blown off course after a sea battle with a chaos fleet. Kalidor was a great mage, and he searched the coasts of the Old World, hoping to find clues to the source of the chaos that was destroying the world. Instead, Kalidor encountered a dwarf army led by Grimnir himself, for they had pursued the remnants of a demon army and sought to slay the last of them. It was a pivotal moment in history, as one of the greatest and most subtle High Elf mages of all time met the brutal and mighty incarnate warrior god of the dwarves. What Grimnir made of this tall and haughty elf mage is not recorded, nor is what Kalidor thought of the tattooed dwarf warlord. Both realized that they were not enemies, and the matter was settled when a force of beastmen attacked. After a hastily agreed alliance, the foe was shattered by the combined might of Grimnir's axes and Kalidor's spells. From Kalidor, the dwarves learned of the great Phoenix King and his struggle to free the distant land of Ulthuan from the grip of chaos. From Grimnir, Kalidor learned of the storm that burst from the north that had preceded the demons. The wise mage concluded that a chaos gate had opened in the utmost north, a doorway between their world and the unimaginable realm of chaos. With this information, and their newly formed alliance, Kalidor departed, in all likelihood already formulating the plan that would lead to the creation of a mighty vortex to suck the unleashed chaos power out of the world. Upon Kalidor's departure, Grimnir presented him with a runic amulet of sovereign protective power. In return, Kalidor gifted the dwarf with the Crystal of Fire, an artifact that is kept to this day in the Great Vault of Karazakarak. The Doom of Grimnir. The respite won by Grimnir and his armies was hard won, but its duration was brief. Even as Grimnir headed back to the mountains, the skies grew ominous. Once more, the tide of chaos rolled over the lands, the demon legions and their untold horrors destroying everything in their path. This time, the demons attacked in such great numbers that the heroism of Grimnir was not enough, and the dwarves were pressed backwards. Unable to hold their ground, the dwarves were eventually forced to retreat inside their strongholds. One by one, their mountain fortresses were besieged. Although they fought valiantly against the tides of chaos, several holds fell to the unholy onslaught. Having heard Kalidor's theory of a chaos gate, Grimnir decided to take action. Ignoring advice, he resolved to trek north and close the gate himself. Grungni told him he would surely die, but Grimnir snarled that it was worth the risk. The great warrior god ritually shaved his head, save for a single defiant crest. He gave one of his axes to his eldest son, Morgrim, and departed for the north. A party of dwarves, led by Morgrim, accompanied Grimnir to the edge of the wastes that lay to the north, fighting off many dangers just to reach this region. There, they at last turned back, watching in awe as Grimnir pressed onwards, his form dwindling into the shimmering haze of that poisoned land. Grimnir was never seen again, and no one knows what befell this most valiant of dwarves. Perhaps he was at last pulled down by an army of monsters. One tale affirms he fought his way to the mountain of the Chaos Gate and held it against an army of demons even as Kalidor completed his spell on Ulthuan. Perhaps an even stranger and more terrible doom overtook him. Of Grimnir's fate, the dwarves do not speak, saying only that he fell in darkness long ago. The Golden Age. In the end, Kalidor's spell drained the rampant magic from the lands, an act that banished the demons to the shadowy corners of the world. In an instant, the armies of unnatural creatures that surrounded each stronghold disappeared, and the dwarves emerged into the dawning of a whole new era. The dwarf gods were gone. Grungi, Valaya, and the lesser deities had disappeared. It was popularly believed that they returned to the mountain's heart, going back from whence they came to emerge again someday when their people most need them. In the World's Edge Mountains, the dwarves' prosperity prospered greatly, but of their kin in the north or from the Mountains of Morn, they had no word. During this age, the strongholds were deepened, expanding into vast underground cities connected by subterranean highways. The elves returned to the old world to establish colonies, and the dwarves eagerly traded with them. A long age of peace and prosperity was begun. In Karazakarak, the High King sat on his carved throne and presided over the dwarf lords who ruled the other strongholds. New allies might be found in the primitive race of man, for although barbaric, the humans looked to the elder races for wisdom and guidance. Alas, it was not to be. And I think that's going to be the end of our video today. I hope you guys enjoyed this. There's a whole lot more to go in the Dwarf book. And I will see you next time.